It is often said that exotic animals make bad pets, but considering that there are so many different types of animals that can be categorized as such, this blanket statement is problematic. Different pets are suitable for different people, and no one animal is perfect for everyone. Nor is pet ownership in general suitable for every individual. Depending on a person's criteria, some animals make better pets than others. Everyone has their own opinions about pets, but one group of researchers took this consideration a bit further. Is it possible to objectively rate animals based on whether or not they make good pets? How can we define what a good pet is? Three Dutch researchers set out to answer this question in their 2016 study, Behavioral Ecology of Captive Species, using bibliographic information to assess pet suitability of mammal species. To accomplish this, the authors sought to develop a framework to assess the suitability of exotic pets utilizing bibliographic information and expert opinion when there was a lack of data on a certain species. The finalized information obtained was to be analyzed by three teams of experts and scientists. The bibliographic information utilized in the study was categorized by what the authors of the study termed one-liners, which they defined as succinct, meaningful, and accurate statement characterizing a species linked with a bibliographic source. The combined analysis of the research teams were then entered into statistical methods to produce the final rank of the mammalian species' suitability as a pet. These subjective assessments consisted of the animal's characteristics in relation to their natural environments, involving their behavioral needs, welfare, health, and a relationship with humans. Behavioral needs of animals are behaviors an animal is motivated to perform, regardless of whether or not its physiological needs are satisfied, and this is thought to be the underlying reason that some captive animals engage in problematic stereotypic behaviors. One such example is the differences between generalist and specialist. Animals that are specialists have adapted to a specific niche in their environment, while generalists have more flexibility and can adapt to more environments. It is thought that animals that are specialists may be more prone to having compromised welfare in captivity when their specialized behavioral needs are not met by their environment. Therefore, an environment they haven't adapted to, such as most captive conditions, could be deemed unsuitable. The authors described their method as a behavioral ecology approach, similar to how zoos attempt to predict the suitability of the species they will maintain. Other factors the researchers proposed to refine their academic findings in a future framework involved the potential danger the animal poses to the caretaker, as well as the threat to the environment, such as with invasive species. It should be also noted that the researchers only analyzed 90 mammals that were kept as pets in the Netherlands and were not classified as production animals. They also did not analyze dogs and cats. After all the data from the research teams were calculated, the study ranked the following species as suitable pets. The Sitka deer came out on top. Next was the agile wallaby, followed by the tamar wallaby, the llama, and last an unusual cat-like creature called the Asian palm civet. However, with stricter criteria, no mammal was deemed suitable out of the 90 mammals. Included in the list of suitable pets with less strict assessment was the red-necked wallaby, common wallaroo, Brazilian guinea pig, golden spiny mouse, Bactrian camel, Himalayan striped squirrel, and the swamp wallaby. It should be noted that in the study, unusual exotic pets like wallabies and the Asian palm civet were ranked as more suitable as a pet than the wily traditional Campbell's dwarf hamster. So what is the takeaway from this study? Is the wallaby really a better pet than a dwarf hamster? Within this study, there was a notable lack of in-depth information about how each species is traditionally cared for, as well as the age the animal will be raised from and whether or not it will undergo intensive socialization. These are imperative factors that will alter an animal's behavior and comfort level with their caretakers. This illustrates the problem with judging an animal's suitability as a pet based on information about the species' characteristics in the wild. In the study, one-liners were used to make assessments about the species, involving husbandry factors such as space requirements, reproductive needs, social needs, and the concept of human-animal interaction, which was abbreviated as HAR. The quality of HAR is dependent on the amount of disturbance humans and animals cause each other, and this involves factors such as whether or not the human caretaker needs specialized knowledge to successfully care for the animal, the potential danger the animal poses to the caretakers, and the degree that the animal is domesticated. The researchers did conclude that domestication, which they described as how long the species coexists closely with human beings, increases the chance of an animal being suitable as a pet, which makes sense. However, the concept of domestication, as is the case in other scientific research, is loosely defined, and different animals were domesticated in different ways. Despite the researchers' extensive efforts, there are many issues with assessing animals based on the interpretation of data from various experts, which consisted of veterinarians and scientists of a PhD education or equivalent. The authors did admit in their paper that even expert opinion can vary based on superficial elements that may, quote, unintentionally be related to size, color, cuddliness, or ugliness of the assessed species. It is certainly true that many scientists that choose to work with and specialize in animals for their careers often have biases that may stem from favoring their subjects. In other words, many scientists are animal lovers, and the quality of their objectivity can become compromised. Furthermore, various cultural ideas of what constitutes a good pet can play a role in how the expert views an animal's suitability. This study is still useful, and it shows us that there are many ways to consider which animals make a good or suitable pet and in what circumstances. There is no universally agreed upon way to define an animal's suitability as a pet, and there are many complexities with animal husbandry and environmental influence involved that go beyond the animal's mere DNA. The study illustrates the importance of judging each species and perhaps each situation of an exotic pet in captivity separately, instead of lumping all animals into one category with blanket statements such as exotic animals make bad pets. We hope you enjoyed this video and learned something new. Please be sure to like, comment, and subscribe.